Thank you. Welcome to our panel on health inequalities. I'm going to get right to it, and Professor Braverman is going to speak first, then I will speak, and then Professor Fulala. Paula Braverman is a physician, professor of epidemiology, no, family and community medicine, I apologize, at University of California, San Francisco. She's been a very influential researcher in the social determinants of health. So I think she will be able to provide a lot of empirical detail and conceptual ideas about some of the issues that were raised by Professor Wilkinson yesterday. Thank you.
Racial inequity create health inequality. That's kind of a mouthful, isn't it? So I want to show you this, showing where the U.S. ranks among other industrialized countries on life expectancy, and tell you that I was part of a study that was done by what was then called the Institute of Medicine, now the National Academy of Medicine in the U.S., and our charge was to see whether what this represented. That we've known for quite a while that the U.S. ranks really low among industrialized countries on life expectancy and on infant mortality. Our charge was to say, is it confined to just particular outcomes, particular age groups? And the results of this study were really shocking, I think, to all of us who participated in it, because we ranked at or near the bottom in the U.S. on almost every health indicator that we looked at, and we looked at over 100 health indicators. So with that in mind, I want to pose a question for you to try to answer in your mind, and maybe you'll want to explore it more in the Q&A, but how can it possibly be that the U.S., which spends more on medical care than any other nation on the face of the earth, and yet we rank at or near the bottom among the industrialized nations on indicators of health? So now I want to give you a little clue to what I think, where the answer may be. And this is a slide. This really comes from a Scottish physician named Thomas McCune, who traced mortality due to various causes. And here I'm just showing you infant mortality in England and Wales from the mid part of the 19th century through around the 1960s. His book was published in 1970, so his data stopped in the 60s. And what you see here is this sort of wavy baseline of the infant mortality throughout the latter half of the 19th century. It's basically the same. And then you see this precipitous drop at around the turn of the 20th century, and that drop kind of continuing. And you know that medical care has really taken the credit for the big advances in life expectancy that have occurred in the course of the 20th century. But this slide raises some questions about that. Because if you think about it, what modalities of medical care did we have really before the 1940s? We didn't have antibiotics until the 1940s. We didn't have penicillin till 1941. Neonatal intensive care units didn't happen until the 60s. And I would challenge anybody here to come up with the modality of medical medical intervention that we had before this time period, I don't think that there was one. And so that precipitous drop, that drop in infant mortality in the early part of the 20th century has been, but many people have studied these charts of McCune, this one and others with different causes of death, but they all kind of have the same basic conclusion from them. But the conclusion is that it was living conditions. It was improvements in living conditions, sanitation, water, nutrition, to some extent, some in working conditions, ventilation specifically, that's what led to these big advances in survival in the 20th century, not medical care. So now I want to show you, these are some national data from the National Center for Health Statistics that my group analyzed, looking at life expectancy at age 25. So this is not life expectancy at birth, but at age 25, how many more years of life can you look forward to? So men on the left, women on the right. And these are arrayed in a pattern that you're going to see in a few of the slides I'm showing you, where will be the dark blue bar on the left will represent the poor, those living at or under 100% of the federal poverty level. And over on the far right is the highest income group. In this case, it's 400% of the federal poverty level or above. And then you've got the groups in between. And what you see is that for both men and women, you see this stepwise gradient pattern. You see the biggest gap between the highest income group and the poor. But you also see these incremental improvements in life expectancy with rising income, and it's not just at the extremes. Now I want to show you this. This is looking at self-reported health, and the measure here is an adverse one. So that's why you see the stepwise gradient going down, that as income goes up, and here we could look at more income groups, as income goes up, the prevalence of people reporting poor health or health that is only fair, which is considered, it's an imperfect health indicator, but it is considered to be, it's considered to be adequate enough for many purposes, and I think that it is for the purpose that we have here, and is widely used as a health indicator, appears in all the Health United States, the routine health publications. And so here you see, as income goes up, that poor or fair self-reported health goes down. And now you're wondering, why is she making such a big deal out of this gradient? And the reason that I am making a big deal out of it is that the relationship between income and health, a causal relationship between income and health, has been disputed. And there still are economists who will say they will not contest the fact that there's a powerful association between income or wealth and health, but they will contest whether it's causal. So one of the reasons for showing you this is to say that I think there are, not only I, but many other people who've studied this believe that there are very good grounds for making a causal inference between income or wealth and health. And if you think about what the criteria are, the relationship should be strong, right? It should be reproducible. The chronologic order should make sense. The income should occur before the measurement of the health, and there have been enough longitudinal studies that have answered that question. It should be biologically plausible, and I'm going to talk about that a little bit more in a few minutes. And then another criterion, a dose-response relationship, and it's not that you have to show a dose-response relationship in order to establish causality, but it really strengthens it terrifically. And here we have the dose-response relationship. And I will tell you that we have looked at scores of indicators, health indicators, across all age groups. And we have found that for the vast majority of the indicators for non-Latino whites and for non-Latino blacks, that this is the pattern that you see. So I want to show you here that you see that same pattern of health varying, health improving as income goes up. You see that within the major racial or ethnic groups. It's not as consistent for the non-Hispanic whites. It's only there about 40% of the time for them, but for whites and for blacks, that stepwise gradient pattern is what dominates. So let's think about, how could income affect health? If we really want to convince these economists that this is plausible, that this, that a causal relationship is really plausible, if you look, there are a number of ways in which income could influence health that are pretty obvious, right? But then there are some that I think are not so obvious. And one of those that's not so obvious is the income gives you the ability to purchase services. Services like childcare, services like transportation, services which can have a big impact on your stress level because they let you cope with challenges in everyday life. And then we know, of course, that stress can have effects on families. It can affect family stability when there's exposure to more stress. And that's just kind of thinking about it cross-sectionally. If you think about it cross-generationally, that the way that income can influence, that the income of the parents can influence the health of their offspring, one of the very important ways is how the income of the parents shapes the educational level of the child. How does that happen? It's basically depending upon whether you can afford to rent or to own a home in an area with good schools. That could have big effects on your child's educational attainment. Or if you're not living in an area where there are good schools, can you afford to send them to private schools? And for most of us who were not born to great inherited wealth, it's our education level that determines the income level that we can reach. And then, of course, and that's through determining the occupation that we can reach, and then the occupation in turn is tied to the income and the work conditions, of course. And this is just this will be the last of these slides arrayed by income, but these are data from a survey that I run in collaboration with the State of California Public Health Department, an annual postpartum survey looking at maternal and infant health in California. And here, what we've done, we've arrayed again from, from the poor on the left to the purple on the right, which are the over 400% of poverty. These are women who are filling out a survey or being interviewed a few months postpartum. And this shows the prevalence of women saying that they experience separation or divorce during their pregnancy. And you just see this dramatic stepwise variant with separation or divorce going way down as you go up on the income ladder. And we found that, I just showed you this slide, we looked at 11 different major stressors during pregnancy, and we found basically this stepwise pattern for all of the for all of those stressors. What about neighborhood? It was just a terrific session on neighborhoods and place and inequality before lunch. And so I think you have a lot of ideas from that about how income, do you think that it's our income that shapes our neighborhood options, right? Where we can afford to rent or buy. And then thinking about how the neighborhood could affect our health, some of the ways are very obvious, like the pollution and the safe places to exercise, the ads for harmful substances, but there are some here also that are not so obvious. For example, the norms and the role models and the peer pressure that children especially are exposed to in a neighborhood. There's a whole literature on this and how that can affect health. And I want to make a comment because a number of the links that I've been talking about are quite obvious, but I'm talking about them because this has been contested, and because what I want you to know that there is a literature, and not a consensus in the literature, but a credible body of literature by respected scientists to back up each one of these links that I've been talking about and the ones that I'm going to be talking about in the next few minutes. The quality of the schools, I think if you think about the sort of, you know, connecting the dots, and I'm going to walk you through this in a minute, the quality of schools, the way that the quality of schools is tied to neighborhood, because the way schools are paid for in this country, where it's dependent on a local tax base, the quality of schools, I think, is probably one of the major transmitters of economic inequality, ultimately leading to health inequality. So here's a pathway through which educational attainment could influence health. And I think this would probably be obvious to most of you. Let me ask, how many of you are from the health field? Okay, thank you. Makes it easier for me to know. Certainly to people in health, but I think even to people who are not in health, the pathway, education affecting health by affecting health knowledge and literacy, which then in turn has an effect on people's diet, their exercise, other health-related habits, and how they manage their disease, if they have disease. So that's the pathway from education to health that I think most people would think about. But there are other equally plausible pathways from education to health that go through work and a lot through income and work-related resources. And you know, it's basically that the link that I mentioned a few slides ago, your educational attainment determines the kind of work that you get. The kind of work that you get determines the income level that you can earn. And then that income level in turn shapes the neighborhood environment in which you live and raise your kids, can shape your diet and exercise options and stress, et cetera, along the lines of what I was talking about a few slides ago. And then there are other ways in which your work can affect your health. The working conditions, physical working conditions are kind of obvious, but there's a literature now on psychosocial aspects of work that tends to support the idea that if you're in a job in which you have very low control, a low degree to control what it is that you do, and high external demand on you, that's pretty toxic in terms of what's happening to your in the physiology of stress in your body. And then obviously the work-related resources like health insurance. But there are yet other pathways from education to health. And with all of these, I say there is a credible literature by respected scientists. Again, I'm not claiming that there is a consensus, but these more psychosocial pathways, including the notion that I just talked about, which is the degree to which you have control over your work, and especially accompanied by the level of external demands. But also, one that I think may be of particular interest to those who were listening to the last panel, but your educational attainment to a large extent determines your social standing, I mean, in this society. And that social standing gives you access to an array of social and economic resources, knowing people who know where you could apply for a job, who can give you a recommendation, But it also, there is evidence that where we see ourselves in a social hierarchy, that in itself seems to have an effect on our health, even after taking into account the more objective measures of social status. And so social status, social standing can be a source of stress, or of either of resources or of stress. So now what I did here, I know that you can't read the lettering, but what I've done here is I put together all three of those pathways that I just walked you through, from education to health. And I want to point out to you that these pathways do not play out over a period of months or even years. Most of them play out over the course of lifetimes. And what I also want to say is that this is incredibly simplistic. So it's so complicated, right? But it's incredibly simplistic because I haven't noted on here anything about the interactions that we know that the items in the different boxes here interact with factors that aren't even up here, or they interact with factors that are up here to modify their effects. And it's really very complex. And so if for you the only valid piece of evidence comes from a randomized clinical trial, you're not going to get that kind of evidence on the effects of education on health. And I would maintain that, and the same is true for income and health too, because this, with this complexity, it does not lend itself to a randomized trial, not to mention what the ethics might be. But that doesn't mean that studies of this can therefore not be rigorous. There are a lot of techniques and a lot of very smart people working on developing even more techniques to deal with the limitations of observational studies in studying where upstream social factors like income and like education, how they can affect health. So I've been talking about socioeconomic factors until now, about income and about education. But what about, but in the title of this talk, I titled it, How Could Economic Inequality and Racism Lead to Health Inequality? So one of the major ways in which racism leads to health inequality is through its socioeconomic effects. So by systematically tracking people of color into neighborhoods of low opportunity where there are inferior schools and inferior opportunities across a whole spectrum of domains. And this is why we see this as the, and it's basically, since it's no longer legal to discriminate, but the legacy of racial discrimination, which was legal until not that long ago, the legacy is there, and it's really manifest in racial segregation is one of the clearest illustrations of it. So how it tracks people of color into lower job opportunities, so lower income, lower wealth, poorer education, less occupational opportunity, and poorer neighborhood quality overall. And so it's really important when you're studying anything where race is a variable, that you need to understand that race is probably capturing unmeasured socioeconomic effects, even if somebody has measured a number of different socioeconomic variables. But there's another way, another major pathway, I would say, through which racism can harm health, and a literature, a really rich and increasing literature on the direct psychological effects of experiencing racism in different ways. And a lot of evidence that chronically stressful experiences that were related to racial discrimination, that such as chronic vigilance, so being on the lookout, feeling that you have to be on the lookout constantly for whether there's going to be an insult. And subtle experiences that are just too subtle to call. So it doesn't have to be dramatic incidents that occur, that these sort of microaggressions, subtle experiences, and even just feeling that you need to be on your guard and vigilant and prepared. And there's some evidence that people's concern about their loved ones experiencing racism can contribute to this sort of chronic stress that's there. And that this can have, that the direct psychological effects of racism can include affecting people's self-doubt and self-esteem. And any of you who study behaviors know that self-esteem is a very big predictor of behavior, and the ability to modify behavior, for example, toward a more healthful pattern. And that these psychological effects are experienced by all socioeconomic groups, not just by the people on the bottom. In fact, there's some reason to believe that it's the people of color who are at the higher end of the socioeconomic spectrum who experience this more. Why is that? Because they're moving in a white world, in a largely white world. That, at least, that's the hypothesis. So is this, I've been talking now for the last few minutes about stress and health. Is that link biologically plausible? And the resounding answer is yes. And that there have been advances in the field of neuroscience in the last 15 to 20 years that they have really shed light on how it is that social factors like income, like education, like racism, how they can get under the skin, so literally into the body. And a number of different physiologic pathways and mechanisms and even brain regions have been shown to be involved in the stress response. A number of different hormones have been shown. And there have even been changes seen in brain architecture and brain function in young children who are exposed to adversity. So there is a pretty strong consensus that chronic stress, and again, not acute stressors, that may be helpful to experience, but experiencing chronic stress over time, even at a very, very low level, that is probably a major contributor to both socioeconomic and racial or ethnic inequalities in health. And this is just a little pictorial illustration of how it works, where we register the stressor on one part of the brain, which sends a signal to another part of the brain, which sends a signal to our adrenal glands, which pump out cortisol, which acutely don't have any bad effects, but it's the high cortisol levels chronically damage organs. And this is just one of the pathways and mechanisms involved. The cortisol is not the only, it's not the only stress hormone. So some of the major scientific advances about the social determinants of health that I think have helped us to understand how it is that economic and social inequality lead to health inequality. They include these advances in neuroscience, the chronic stress as a real big one. But another area is in how childhood experiences shape adult health. And just even in the last 10 to 20 years, I'd say there's been a growing awareness that the experiences in childhood and specifically adversity in childhood seems to be very strongly predictive of the development of chronic disease later in adulthood. I think that a major scientific advance has been beginning to understand how it is that racism shapes health and across how it does so across a lifetime, but also across generations. And then in the area of epigenetics or gene-environment interactions has just turned a lot of science on its head. by saying this, you can have this, these, this adverse gene profile, but if you're not exposed to these adverse environmental, including in the social environment, these conditions, you're not going to express that adverse gene. And a quote that I love from somebody, emeritus professor at UC Davis, named Judith Stern, she said, genes load the gun, but the environment pulls the trigger. And I love that. So I think here, in terms of time, I will just do that very quickly, and I'm not going to go through this very much, except to say that this is a model that I love, that I find very useful in thinking about the social determinants of health. This was developed by somebody named Finn Diderichsen, who's now at the University of Copenhagen, and he did it to illustrate how, what generates health inequality across a lifetime and across generations. And one of the things one of the many things about this that I think is great is that he shows how your social position, which is represented, for example, by your class and by race, if you're in a racially unequal country as we are, it doesn't only determine differential exposure to factors that can be health promoting or health damaging. It also determines differential vulnerability to the effects of that exposure. And then finally, that it determines the consequences, that according to your social position, the consequences of you having a given health problem are different. And what do I mean about the consequences, and specifically the social consequences? Well, let's say if I was in a bad accident and I lost the use of my legs, so it would be devastating, right? But I could still go on working because I'm a university professor. But the woman who cleaned my room at the hotel this morning, what would be the consequences for her if she had exactly the same injury? The consequences for her and for her children, they would be very, very different. And Diederichsen was challenging people to think about the responsibility of looking for how to reduce inequality at every step along here, not just in the exposures. So now I'm almost done, but I want to look at that. So I'm showing you that because for me it really captures, admittedly a caricature, but it captures what's the dominant way that we help people deal with stress in this country, right? We exhort them to behave better. We tell them they should do something about their stress. And so that leads me back to that that question that I posed to you at the beginning, which is how can it be that the U.S. spends so much on medical care and yet we do so poorly on health? Could the answer be that we focus too narrowly, that we focus on a lot on medical care, that's where most of the money goes, and then we focus on behaviors by telling people, as in the cartoon, telling people how they ought to be behaving and what they ought to be doing to reduce the stress in their life. And we're not paying attention to what it is that not only shapes behaviors and shapes medical care, but also directly affects health, and some through the pathways involving stress. And these are the living and the working conditions that people experience. And we're not looking at what it is that sorts people into healthy and unhealthy living and working conditions, the basic economic and social opportunities and resources, so basically the money, the education, the power, and the inclusion and or acceptance or prestige in society, that many of us believe that we have been focusing too narrowly, and we haven't looked at what ends up systematically sorting people into healthy and unhealthy living and working conditions according to the wealth and the skin color of the parents that they happen to be born to. And that we have done too much to lay the burden on the individual to do something about the unhealthy factors in their lives. And that what we haven't recognized that although individual responsibility is very important, it's absolutely essential, but that that too many people experience obstacles to health that only society could do something about. Thanks very much. I'll end there.
Wow, that was just terrific. Thank you. I'm Bill Gardner. I'm a psychologist by training. I'm in the Department of Epidemiology at the University of Ottawa. So I have a familiar title here. Let me be clear about what I'm going to talk about and not talk about. I'm going to talk about racial inequality in mortality and try to use it to talk about how we go about valuing lives. I am writing this talk to try to make a connection to the philosophical themes. I'm not a philosopher, so it's what a philosophy looks like from the point of view of somebody who does my work on trying to change healthcare systems. I'm not going to talk about the Black Lives Matter movement in any way. So it's not something I feel like I know enough about or have valuable opinions on. I'm going to talk about how lives matter. And I'll try to make it clear what that means. I'm going to contrast two points of view on the value of lives, what I'll call the epidemiological view and the political view. And I have to warn you that there's going to be some disturbing images because I think they're part of the history of this topic. But there's a child here earlier. If by any chance there's anybody young here, that's probably not the talk they should be at. Okay. This is Eric Garner. 2 years ago now, he has been put into a chokehold. He falls to the ground, experiences a respiratory crisis, which in a certain way is what a chokehold is supposed to trigger. Dies without receiving adequate medical attention. His last words are, "I can't breathe," and he says that 11 times. Now, I'm going to try to talk about differences in the way white people and black people die and what they mean. But first, let's start from thinking about what it means to take an epidemiological point of view on this. Epidemiologists count lives and measure their lengths. I mean, they do many other things, but this is one of when you're focusing on mortality, that's what you're looking at. And compare populations on those measures. All lives count equally from an epidemiological point of view, no matter how someone dies. So there would be, for example, thinking about Eric Garner's death, he was just a death. And there wouldn't be any epidemiological view about whether he deserved to die or not. That's not the concern here. Now, if we look at black and white mortality, almost all the data I have are from the CDC, although eventually there will be a little bit of historical data. Whites live 3.1 years on average more than blacks. It's about a 4% difference. If you look at the bars, it doesn't seem like that much. But let's look at it another way. There were 640,000 black children born in 2011. That's the cohort of people for whom that life expectancy of birth applies to. If they lose 3.1 years of life across their lifespan, that's 2 million life years lost in a cohort, which is, if you just stop and pause and think about how much learning and playing with children and musical expression and everything else that goes into a life that's lost there, that makes 3.1 years lost per person look a little bit different, I hope. Let's look at it. And this is considerably more, for example, than something else we're all very concerned about, which is the total years of life lost each year due to smoking. And so this is for one cohort. This is being reproduced, each cohort ongoing, unless we solve the problem. Now, if you think about it, the most important valuable property we own are our lives. If we think about the loss of years of life from our lifespan as being property damage to us, which is, I know, a kind of artificial, funny way to think about it, but go with me with this for a moment. And we put $100,000 value on a year of life, which is not an implausible value the way cost effectiveness calculations are done. That's $200 billion of damage suffered by each ongoing cohort of black children. That, again, is a large amount of damage. It's considerably greater than the total property damage associated with automobile accidents in a given year. Another way to scale it would be the total damage of Hurricane Katrina, estimated at $135 billion. So if you convert units here, you can think of the property loss for a given cohort as being a Katrina and a half. Now, what's the point of doing that, right? I mean, we don't make policy decisions this way, nor should we. The reason I'm making this point is that the loss of life suffered by a cohort of people like that is invisible, it's distributed over a lot of time and over a lot of people. If you convert it into this, it suddenly looks like a catastrophe, right? Because there's a lot more damage that just got done. That's the point of trying to come to this dollar expression of what's happening. My point is that 3.1 years difference in life expectancy really matters across a population. Now, let's go back to the notion of people being killed by police. These are data actually collected by the Washington Post about all the people who've been killed by police in 2015. What I'm plotting on the vertical axis is the deaths per 100,000 population for blacks, whites, and other races. The statistic in the upper right is the relative risk, and that's, in this case, the chance that a black person will be killed by a policeman in a given year divided by the chance that a white person will be killed. And you can see that there's a really big disparity there. You're 2.7 times as likely to be killed if you are black. But I want to draw your attention again to the vertical axis. It's deaths per 100,000, and the top peak there is one. So you have one chance, there's one in 100,000 black people will die by police killing, justified or not. Remember, we're not making any distinction at all about that. And that ends up being only 0.1% of black deaths. So if you think about it epidemiologically, a loss of a life is not trivial, but as a cause of blacks dying, it is. It's not making any discernible impact on the life expectancy difference. Okay, hold that fact in mind. So what does make a difference? This is from the CDC, and what it does is it breaks down the effect of different causes of death on the loss or gain in life expectancy by the races. So the green lines towards the bottom, those are causes of death for which there's actually a black advantage. For example, at the bottom, blacks are less likely to die by suicide than whites, and they gain relatively 0.2 years of life expectancy from that. At the top, blacks are more likely to die from heart disease. They lose a whole year that way. They lose 0.6 years through cancer, and then they lose a half a year by being more often victim of homicide, a third of a year from diabetes, and a third of a year from perinatal conditions, about which I'll say more in a minute. Now, there is a picture of black life, which is, you know, that it's nasty, brutish, and short. Okay? I hope you can look at this and say, yes, there is a problem of more blacks dying by homicide, but mostly what kills black people are what kills white people. Heart disease and cancer, but they're more likely to kill black people. And here is one of many points in this talk I could just say, and I would like Professor Braveman to get back up and give her talk again so we can go through the many reasons why that might be true. Now, what do we want to look? I think I really want to look at this historically for a moment. And what I'm doing here is I'm graphing the life expectancy and birth by race over the last century and 10 years, the last 111 years. And what you see, first of all, is that for both races, it's been a tremendous thing, right? The increase in life expectancy has been spectacular in the last century. There's that interesting blip at 1919, that's the Spanish influenza, right? But overall, it's really terrific what's happened. And one thing, you ought to look at this and say, you know, the black experience in some sense is not that different from the white experience for life expectancy. It's just shifted in time a few years later. And that makes sense. Africa was at a lower level of economic development than Europe at about the time this slavery transportation happened. Slavery transportation would have set life expectancy back a considerable bit. And nothing that happened much in between slavery and modern times would have reduced that. So there's a reason for this delay in history, but overall, for black people, things are getting better if you look at life expectancy in a really important way. On the other hand, you can also see that there's a persistent difference in inequality. But the interesting thing is that difference is dropping. In 1900, there was a 15-year difference in life expectancy. In 2011, as we've already seen, it's down to 3.1 years. If you calculate that difference from each year, just subtracting, and graph that, you get this. And what you see is a steadily falling race difference in life expectancy at birth. And I have dared to put on the title to the top of the slide, The Arc of the Moral Universe. This is a reference to Dr. King's quote, "The arc of the moral universe is long, but it bends toward justice." In a small way, there is that arc, okay? So I think that there are reasons that I won't go into, I don't want to take the time, to think that the rate at which The race difference disappearing, is slowing. So I think we are still decades away from it going away. But things are getting better. Now here, this is taking present-day data, and what I've done on the horizontal axis is those ages in the human lifespan. And at each age, I have graphed the relative risk of being black to white. So that 100% line is a situation where there's the same mortality risk at every age for both races. The peak on the left is showing really, really high disparity in mortality risk for infants for blacks. Okay? So that where, even though it doesn't necessarily have the biggest effect, that remember that was cancer and heart disease, and we can go through the math of why that's true. There's really this major difference in what happens in early childhood to blacks and whites that puts blacks at a significant life expectancy disadvantage. It then plateaus in childhood through adulthood at about a 50% disadvantage, and then it falls, and I think that's really because there's been a process of selecting out all but the most robust black people, and in a certain sense, the survivors in the cohort at that point are constitutionally healthier than white people. That's why I think there's even a slight advantage at a very late elderly point. And it's really interesting that this curve showing how the disparate risk varies by age itself changes historically. Now here's how this graph works. The red line is how that relative risk by age curve was in 1930. And you see there wasn't such a pronounced infant risk, but there was a much higher, up to 300%, mortality risk in the prime of adulthood. But over time, that big hump in the center has fallen from 1930 to 1990 to 2000, down to 2011. I've got to actually get into the finer data on the causes of death to understand this. I'm going to speculate, though, it's changing occupational status for black people. This is also partly the migration out of the Deep South of field labor and such like. Okay. And here is where I was going to start to say something a bit more about infancy, and this is data for Janet Curry about low birth weight among black infants and related problem of prematurity, where again, there's a great disadvantage for black mothers and infants, but I think Professor Braidman covered this in great detail, so I'm going to move on. And I want to talk to you again about the same problem from a different point of view. And I hope that as you were listening to me, there was something very troubling about what I was saying. Because one way to read it was, why all the fuss about a few people get killed by the police? Because it doesn't make a big difference in these kind of calculations. But I think that part, this is the difference about how we value things. Life is more than just how long it lasts. We have to think about what makes it valuable. And the most important value in politics is freedom. Now, I know I need to make an argument for that, but you all believe it, so I won't bother, okay? Now, here's a perspective from a philosopher on one way of thinking about freedom. There are many other ways, but I think it applies to the situation quite well. It's from Philip Pettit. A person is free to the extent that others do not stand over him or her, able to interfere at will and with relative impunity in his or her affairs. It's freedom is non-domination is the idea. Elaboration of it from a guy named Nicholas Broussalis. I hope I'm pronouncing that right. This is from the journal Ethics, so it's still written in Martian. I'll try to translate, maybe. A dominates B if A and B are embedded in a systematic relationship in which A takes advantage of his power over B, and this is the important part, in a way that is disrespectful to B. And by disrespectful, I don't mean discourteous. What I mean is the notion of respect here is something more like I treat you as if you are in the same moral community as me. Right? So I value your interests in the way you value your interests, and I recognize that. And there's a lot to be said, but that's something like the idea. So I'm going to go through some of the history here. We'll start with the Middle Passage. This is a famous an abolitionist pamphlet about a famous trial of a slaving captain who was amazingly tried for torturing a slave. And I want to point to you not just the character of the torture, that she was being hung by her ankle, but also how the whole thing shows complete disrespect for her modesty in a way that a white woman would not have been treated. You can fill in the details about slavery yourself. I'm going to point out here a phenomenon that happened in post-Reconstruction, I guess, really would be the right way to put it. Work camps were this interesting thing across, mostly to my knowledge, across the South, where black men would be picked up on charges like vagrancy, small offenses, demanded to pay a fairly exorbitant fine. Of course, they couldn't. They would be imprisoned away from their families until they could pay, in effect, a life sentence for vagrancy. And they were worked, and their labor was sold and contracted for by the people running the prison, and they died and they were buried in mass graves. Anywhere else, we would call that a concentration camp. But it was part of the experience of the time. Now we're getting to the images that are difficult. This is from the Elaine massacre. I've seen various counts of how many people died. It's a race riot, I guess you'd call it, or a pogrom. The white community rampaged through the black areas of this town and county in Arkansas. At least 250 people were executed in mass hangings. This is a New York Times map showing the prevalence of lynching. It shows an interesting aspect of the Times worldview. It only shows the South, whereas in fact lynching occurred throughout the states, including in Ohio, but that's apparently not the way that the Times thinks about the world. And here are data on lynching by race and over historical periods. Now, white people were lynched, okay? What that is basically showing is that justice was different in the 19th century than we understand it. A lot of it was vigilante. And there are some states where most of the people lynched were, in fact, white. But you can see clearly, again, the vertical axis is lynching per 100,000 people, that the overwhelming preponderance were black people. This is Liege Daniels. And I put this up for a couple of reasons. I want you to look at the crowd. These are people who are not concerned that they're at the scene of a crime. They're not really thinking that anything particularly horrible has happened. You've noticed they've brought their children. This picture, and actually the picture of Elaine, it's quite interesting. It's a postcard. Does anybody know what a postcard is, or is that knowledge kind of gone? Yeah, it still maybe is a cultural memory. It was what Instagram is now, in a way. And people in towns would manufacture these and sell them after the event as mementos, or you could write them. And a lot of the photographs we have as lynchings come from collections of postcards. It's true. Okay? And this is actually the courthouse for Waco there. So this is not a, this is, my point is, there's a statement here about what this community felt like it was entitled to do to the black community. Now here's an even more difficult one. By the way, both Jesse Washington and Lige Daniels were teenagers. This is again a shot from outside a courthouse in Texas. He was hung with a chain, and then after being hung, his body was lowered into a bonfire. And I believe he was castrated as well. I am never going to be able to unsee the young man in the lower corner. Again, there is a sense of, I don't think we ought to read these, I don't personally, read these white spectators as sociopaths. I think they had a conception of what they were doing as being an expression of the kind of justice that their community was entitled to carry out, but they would not necessarily have carried out on somebody from their community. Now here's the last one of these things. I'll make an overall point about it. This is a very famous photograph, but it's the most difficult. This is Emmett Till. You can't tell because, he was shot. This is in Chicago at his funeral, but he was visiting family in Mississippi. He was shot, and then his body was mutilated, which is what you can see on his face. You can't tell he's 14 years old, was 14 years old. This is an extraordinarily important photograph. It was published in black newspapers and magazines across the country. It had enormous effect on changing opinions and stimulating a revival of the civil rights movement. It would have happened without it, doubtlessly, but this was a pivotal event. If you are a student and you don't know who Emmett Till was, make sure you sign up for a 20th Century American History course, because there's something you've got to learn there. Now here's my point about the political view versus the epidemiological view. It seems to me that what these, even though if you, I should go back, just make one point that okay. The scale again of lynching is in lynchings per 100,000, we only get up to 2. Again, it's a trivial effect on the life expectancy. You weren't very likely to die of lynching if you were a black person. And yet, I would argue that these events had profound cultural effects, right? The mutilation of a corpse, the abuse of Jesse Washington's corpse, has nothing to do with epidemiology, right? The person's already dead. It doesn't matter what happens to the body for those calculations. But it has everything to do in setting a boundary on who's in our moral community and who is not. We consider ourselves a group of civilized people, do not treat our dead that way, but we treat their dead that way. And this is, and in some sense, this kind of public execution and mutilation enacts a sort of cultural statement of values about who we are and who they are. And you don't have to do it very often to make that point. So my point here, I guess, is that it's extraordinarily important to take the epidemiological point of view, because the fundamental differences in mortality and life expectancy are pervasive across time and across social settings and across age and across a lot of things, and you have to address them all through ongoing, hard, systematic work to fix the problem. But at the same time, we have to think, there's a reason why deaths of this kind have such an important role, because they have such a definitive role in who we are as a moral community. Now, I want to be very clear. I am not saying that Eric Garner was lynched. I think there's fundamental differences between the recent killings and what happened here. However, a situation where someone is killed for arbitrary reasons and the killers are unpunished and they have the sort of all the badges of authority and law does make a moral statement if the problem is not corrected. So it's not lynching, but it speaks to a similar problem of domination of one community by another and of respect of one community for another. So, I'll just say a couple more things. I don't know anything about criminology. I don't know anything really about jurisprudence, but it seems to me that we have the fundamental intellectual principles that really need to be applied here in the notion of equal justice under law. And lots of people of goodwill are working on the problem, including this police chief. So, thank you very much. And I'll just comment in a way. When I first saw the, I'm not, for reasons that would be obvious, in a position to say I can speak for the black experience. However, I will speculate that the slogan and the words, "I can't breathe," in light of the images of lynching that are burned into the historical memory of black people, that meant something different for that community than it meant for my community. So, thank you very much. So, Bob is going to be our next speaker. Robert Fullalove is, what? Oh, I'm sorry. He is Associate Dean for Community and Minority Affairs and Professor of Sociomedical Science at Columbia University. He's a BA of Colgate, MS at Syracuse, has his doctorate from Columbia. And he has personally influenced my thinking and research by his pathbreaking work on community participation and how to promote it in research process.
You can imagine that as a black man standing up after those images, it's not typically the way I prepare for a talk. However, as an extremely useful way of getting into what I hope will be an effort to synthesize many of the points of view that have been represented over the course of the last couple of days, I think was an excellent starting point. I want to talk about health disparities. I want to talk about mass incarceration. I want to talk about mass incarceration as a community phenomenon. I want to try and do it in about 15 minutes so that we have time to have some conversations about all the things that you've heard thus far. I want to point out that I have been at Columbia University since 1990. I arrived with Mindy Thompson Fullalove, and a key point in the history of New York, January of 1990, when in the following month, in the New England Journal of Medicine, McCord and Freeman, two physicians connected to Columbia University but working at Harlem Hospital, published a groundbreaking study that had as its title excess mortality in Harlem. It made the front page of the Times, which is not something that typically happens with a publication from the New England Journal. Why did it make front page headlines? Because it pointed out that if you looked at data up until 1980, black men in Harlem had less of a chance of reaching the age of 65 than men in Bangladesh, that the average life expectancy, using the data that they had available from the New York City Department of Health and the census data, the average life expectancy for an African-American male in that town was 49 years. What's remarkable is that this is a data set that came 1 year before we observed HIV/AIDS. So that those data do not include, amongst other things, HIV as a principal cause of death. And it's an important way of sort of understanding health disparities because at this point in our history, HIV/AIDS is one of the leading racial ethnic health disparities in the United States, with roughly 45% to 48% of all new cases of HIV every year occurring in African Americans. This has a great deal to do with what you heard this morning in the conversation about the war on drugs and mass incarceration. And let me see if I can tie the two together. Richard Nixon, you may recall from the talk this morning, in 1970 declares drugs are public enemy number one. The DEA is formed in 1973, the Drug Enforcement Agency. And what we typically identify as the war on drugs begins then. By 1980, roughly half of all the arrests in the United States are associated with drug-related crimes, not just sale and possession. And it becomes clear that we have really changed the track that we have as a nation around issues of crime and punishment. Now, from a public health standpoint, June 1981 is when we first identified the existence of HIV/AIDS in our midst. The Morbidity and Mortality Weekly Report, published by the CDC, has an article that notes that there were five men in Los Angeles who showed up at a clinic with an old man's cancer, Kaposi's sarcoma. The notion was, whoa, isn't this interesting? These are young folk. They're identified and linked by their lifestyle. They're gay. But for all intents and purposes, the fact that they're so young and looking at a cancer that we typically associate with the late 60s means that something must be going on. This is what we typically describe as the beginning of the AIDS epidemic. But the question is, was it really? If you think about how the two are tied together, and you know anything about HIV, the first thing that you will recall from your education, which I hope you students got in high school, is that HIV begins as an asymptomatic infection that may take 10 to 12 years to manifest itself as AIDS. In that 10 to 12 years, people look, act, and for all intents and purposes, are in good health. But if you understand that Kaposi's sarcoma is an AIDS-defining condition, what we're essentially saying is that in 1981, we noticed AIDS at the point that it had become the end stage of that disease, which means that the real beginning of the epidemic isn't the 1980s, it's the 1970s, or perhaps as early as 1968-69. Doesn't matter. The point is, if you combine the two, the war on drugs and the HIV epidemic, it becomes clear that the real beginning of the epidemic was in many respects seeded by that as a public policy, we decided to lock up the one group in the United States that had the greatest risk of being exposed to HIV. Remember that needle sharing, which is the principal way in which those who abused drugs got this infection in the early days, was one of the more efficient ways of making sure that the virus entered the bloodstream from some other person. Sex is not that efficient as a transmitter of this virus. So the notion that we had a large population, growing population, locked up, and in many instances in facilities where, as you heard again this morning, drugs were present, where there is a lot of consensual and non-consensual sex, has led a lot of us to believe that one of the major causes that drove this epidemic into the Black and Latino communities was mass incarceration. When I started doing HIV/AIDS research with Mindy, it was in 1986 in San Francisco. We were part of the organizing group of what is now the Center for AIDS Prevention Studies. At that point in our history, we were talking in our publications about the fact that 27% of the folks who were struck by this epidemic were Black. By 1996, we're now at the point where roughly half of the new infections are occurring in the African American population, and it becomes clear that there has to have been some link between having so many folks locked up and having this growing rate of infection, which by the 1990s was the number one killer of adult black males and females between the ages of 19 and 44. I want to point out that this had community impacts as well. I think it's important to understand that New York State had a prison population that was rapidly growing with respect to HIV/AIDS. In 1992, 25% of all the inmates in prison in the United States who were living with AIDS were in prisons in upstate New York. Neighborhood phenomenon. Eddie Ellis, in the New York Times in 1992, writes another front page op-ed piece in which he points out that there were 7 neighborhoods in New York City that supplied 74% of the New York State prison population. It's a way of saying that prisons in upstate New York were really neighborhood institutions of neighborhoods in New York. And understand that these 7 neighborhoods are the ones that have, to this day still, the highest HIV background seroprevalence rates of just about any other set of urban areas in the United States, with the possible exception of our nation's capital, where 5% of the black males in that city are living with an HIV infection. It's a way of sort of describing the degree to which this is really not just an individual phenomenon, that mass incarceration has community impacts that are dramatic in their consequences. Please understand, too, that when we talk about mass incarceration, we're really talking about something that has to be considered a system. We're so accustomed, because of our films and our TV, of thinking about the prison and the folk on the inside, and we see that as, and I love the way young people have done this, a thing. But you have to understand that mass incarceration includes 5 million people who are under community supervision. They're on parole, on probation, or under the supervision of the courts. And where are they? Well, they're in those 7 neighborhoods. That is to say that they go to prison from these neighborhoods, and in the United States, they come back to these neighborhoods. There's been a 68% increase in the number of formerly incarcerated persons who are now in poor communities of color as a result of the circulation between the prison and the community that has to have seeded the epidemic in the community as well as in the prisons. It's a neighborhood phenomenon. One way in which you might look at this, and this is one of the things that I used to do with the PowerPoint, is to focus on the concept of the million-dollar block. You can look this up, by the way, on Google. Million-dollar blocks incarceration. Do it that way. You'll see a set of images from colleagues in New York City in which they describe the following. A million-dollar block is a block where, were you to identify all the people who are resident on that block, who are currently doing time in a prison, and multiply that times $60,000 in New York City, which is the amount that we spend per year to keep somebody locked up, you'd have a bunch of million-dollar blocks. If you were to Google as well, health disparities in New York City, 2004, you'll come across a very neat and very well done PDF file from the New York City Department of Health that looks at, amongst other things, a series of maps of asthma, drug abuse death, diabetes, cardiovascular disease, drug overdose. I can go on and on and on. And in these maps of New York City, you will see the same blocks as having the highest rates of these conditions as the million-dollar blocks that are identified in the other maps. I love to do the back and forth between the million-dollar blocks PDF and the reports PDF, just as a way of sort of demonstrating that we're not simply talking about something that affects the individual. If you think about how this works, every single year, 700,000 people are returned from prison to their communities. And it's important to understand of the 2.2 million people who are currently in prison, roughly one half are there not because they've committed new crimes, but because they've violated the conditions of their parole. And in New York City, if a cop rolls up on you and you're on parole and you don't have anything that identifies where you are living, that is a formal violation of your parole and you go back to the joint. It's a way of sort of saying that this is a way of reinforcing the inequalities that we've been talking about over the course of the last day and a half, and it has dramatic impacts, obviously, on health. Much of what we talked about thus far in this conference has been, at least for me, really depressing. I hope I'm not alone in that. But because I think what we've done, and this is what we love to do in public health, because we, after all about life and death, with a real focus on death, is that we're very good at describing how bad things are and terrible at figuring out how to solve them. I know that the average Columbia University student in public health will basically hear a series of lectures throughout his or her time there, where they will hear about 80% of their lectures about the problems and only a few lectures about solutions. If you look at the American Journal of Public Health, do this yourself. Look to see how many of the articles that are databased are really describing, oh man, look how bad this is over here. And then tell me how many of them not only are doing evaluation of health and public health interventions, tell me how many of those evaluations give us good news. Well, I want to give one that has everything to do with the ways in which the school-to-prison pipeline is alive and well and a major driver of the factors that I've just been describing. The average inmate doing time in a state or federal prison is probably somebody who did not finish high school, or if he or she did, they're functionally illiterate. 61.4% of folk who are basically not at the 12th grade level with respect to their education. And this obviously has a great deal to do with what happens when they go back to their communities. At this point in the 21st century, who gets a job with less than a high school diploma? It's a way of saying that if we don't use the time that people are incarcerated to, at the very least, do as the law in most states describes, give people a minimum amount of education so that they can qualify for jobs in their communities. If we haven't done that, then we've really failed in our responsibilities to create a civil society that is worthy of a democracy, worthy of our version of democracy. So it's been real interesting for me to spend a good portion of my time these days teaching as part of the Bard Prison Initiative. BPI made the headlines a couple of months ago when a debate team of students at Eastern New York Correctional Facility, a maximum security prison in Ulster County, New York, defeated a debate team from Harvard. And it really defeated. Now, the Daily News, if you know anything about New York, said, please. Right, they're a bunch of liberals. They got over. It was clear that they just sort of folded in the face of their desire to do the right thing by these poor, oppressed men. And of course, the Daily News would never use the term oppressed. But if you look at what actually happened in that debate, you get some sense for what it means to get an education on the inside. And what for me is even more important, who is actually locked up there? They were asked to debate the following position in the affirmative. The United States should by law permanently exclude all immigrants in the United States who are here illegally from ever having access to a public education paid for by the taxpayer. They had to debate for that position. How many of you in the audience could win a debate where that was what you had to argue? You want to raise it? This is the kind of thing where I know you can't raise your hand, but I think it's an oratorical device that works very well. Here's what they did. They said, if you look at the quality of public education in the United States, it becomes abundantly clear that there is no greater harm you could do to a student. And to force them to go to a public school in the neighborhoods where we are from, where most folk who are here in this country illegally would be sending their kids to school. They won. Bard has been around since 1999 on its own dollars because the Congress in 1994 permanently suspended the ability of a college to give Pell Grants to inmates in prison. And as a consequence, the fact that in 1999 they started to run a degree granting program, the same that a student at Bard College in upstate New York gets, in prison. The fact that they decided to do this in six of the institutions in their immediate vicinity and have been continuing this up to this day really represents something of an existence proof, proof of concept, if you will, that is worth examining. It has, since its beginning, enrolled a little less than 400 students. It's passed out about a little less than 275 degrees. I've been teaching in the three facilities, Taconic, Fishkill, and Woodbourne, where, as medium security institutions, people have a likelihood of getting out within 2 to 3 years. And I've been teaching a course with other colleagues at Columbia University that are essentially introduction to public health. There's a public health concentration that inmates can have that will allow them to graduate with a BA, having the kinds of skills that are basically going to render them capable to work with departments of health as health ambassadors, as patient navigators, as outreach workers, for all the work we're trying to do to enroll people in poor communities in New York in the Affordable Care Act. The governor of New York, in talking about this program, made the following observation. If it costs the state of New York $60,000 a year to keep an inmate locked up, what is the return on the investment? Roughly 50% will be back within 3 years. For $60,000 a year, that's not buying us very much. By contrast, students at the Bard College Prison Initiative, if they graduate, are likely to go into their communities, and the recidivism rate for them is considerably lower. It costs $5,000 to provide that kind of college education, and the recidivism rate is 4%. 4%. That is dramatic. And I have to tell you, with two of my students currently pursuing masters in epidemiology in public health at Columbia University, I'm really aware of exactly the competence that these folk possess. I'm fond of saying to them, you have to understand, the best minds in our community, unfortunately, aren't in our community. Too many of them are up here. If you're in a position, I tell them, to understand and do well in a lecture given by scholars at Columbia University, it becomes very, very clear that you have the capacity, the capability, and the panache to do the kinds of thing in your community when you return that may turn things around. I point out to them that I'm an old guy. In 1964, as a sophomore at Colgate University, I went south to be a field secretary for the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee and spent 3 years on and off doing civil rights work and community organizing in the state of Mississippi. The standard tactic we used as community organizers, getting people to register to vote in a state that was very much accustomed to lynching people for even talking about voting, was to go to the men in the community and say, what are we going to do? It's a new age. It's a new time. Do you understand, and we used to say this tongue in cheek, that your son could become the president of the United States? That was 52 years ago. We said it, tongue in cheek, oh my, oh my. And I point out to the men that, and I'm now at Taconic, which is a women's facility, I point out to them, you have to understand that you are part of something that the New York Times described in an op-ed piece in April of 2015 as the 1.5 million missing black men in the United States. Do you remember that article? It said that for every 100 black women you can find in the US, only 83 black men can be found. In Ferguson, Missouri, the subject of one of the many police tragedies involving members of the black community, for every 100 black women in Ferguson, you can only find 40 black men. It's a way of saying that one of the things that happened with the HIV/AIDS epidemic and so many of the men being locked up in the community, the collective efficacy, to use a term that was used this morning, that we in public health rely on to underscore our efforts to do effective community-based interventions for things like HIV/AIDS, was crippled because you weren't there. The average time that my students have been locked up is in excess of 22 years. I've got students who've got 30 years under their belt, who know they're never going to get out, who still attend classes, pose questions, jump in my face, And I don't like my Columbia students who, because of my advanced years, don't want to do anything to unsettle me. These guys are the ones who say, Doc, where did you get these numbers? Are you sure that the assumptions they use to conduct this analysis are really valid? The idea that we are now seeing, and I'm speaking to an audience of folk in one of the premier institutions of higher education in the country, a way in which the true value of education, the notion that it has the capacity to create in a population that, for all intents and purposes, could be deprived of hope, a vision of the future that not only includes their own redemption, their own salvation, but a way of redeeming the communities from which they fled and which has suffered the consequences of their loss. The notion that they have a chance to go back armed with an education that can make a difference, I would suggest to you, is an idea whose time has come. One of the things that superintendents of these facilities will argue is that because we've got the best minds in class, the level of security in the institution goes up dramatically. Instead of spending a lot of time thinking about how to make trouble just to deal with the boredom of being on the inside, I've got them in class reading the New England Journal of Medicine. I want to suggest that it's not just an idea whose time has come. In a conference where we focused a lot on bad news, let me say, as somebody who spent a lot of time in a seminary, this is the good news. That there's something about what we're able to do, the power that we know is vested in education, can in fact make a dramatic difference in many of the things that we've talked about over the course of the last day and a half. And if it is in the power of anybody in this room to think about what could be done, if the BPI program were extended to some of the institutions here in the state of Ohio, give me a call. We should get busy. Thank you.
So we have time still for questions, I hope.
Bill, please. The analogy being primarily to the disability adjusted life year, the quality adjusted life year, or, you know, as you put it. So normally in that calculation, is there not a correction factor? And, you know, because in the ones that I just stated, there are. And so would not that have exacerbated the scenario?
No, Daryl, you're absolutely right. The problem, of course, is that there's it's really hard to settle on how to make those adjustments.
Yes.
But if for example the black population is living with more chronic illnesses, mm-hmm. which follows from the data, then you would count the difference in disability adjusted life years possibly as being greater. Mm-hmm. And that's your point, I think it's correct.
Right. But it was really neat done. I'm gonna use your slides.
I'm happy to show them.
I guess I have the mic. Oh, you don't need that. Okay. So I'm trying to sell biology here, and I think there is hope for solutions in biology, including biology in these kinds of analysis.
Can everybody hear it in the back?
Specifically neurobiology, but let me say something. I think the idea that these individuals were outside of the moral community is a euphemism. I think the strategy seems to be dehumanizing the other person, and I think if you look at the Holocaust, you see similar images. And you're right, it's striking how when you see these images of sadism, of community sadism, right, we don't have to say they're sociopaths or psychopaths, they're always smiling, right? So there's something, a biological drive here. But aren't we at the point where I don't think the term race, I think using the term race is another way to dehumanize. I think at least the argument that there are no biological races can be made. I'm convinced there are no biological races. And what we're really talking about here is ethnic differences. And, but using the term race is a way to dehumanize the person that looks different.
So that's an extremely good question. There's an article I'd point you to by Philip Kitcher, a very well-known philosopher of many things, including science, about the status of the concept of race. I absolutely agree with the idea that we don't want to speak of race as speaking to some sort of biological essential. But I do think that there is something that we all can refer to, even though we our understanding of what it means could vary a lot, that at least enables me to arrange these data. I'd love to give a talk someday on what the concept of race means, but it would certainly take your criticism into account, because I don't think it's a simple term at all, and that the talking about what it means, it has to be done both in terms of a certain amount of biological understanding of what populations represent, but also cultural definitions and so on and so forth. What it means changes year by year biologically, right? I mean, that one group of people, the population of genes that represents it, is constantly changing dynamically, right? But of course, that's, anyway, so yes, good question.
I have a question for Professor Vollilove about the BARD program.
Yeah.
How do you know that the recidivism rate that you're seeing is a selection effect, or a treatment effect, and not a selection effect?
It quite possibly could be, but who cares? I mean, part of what, you have to understand that part of what's going on here is that the quality of education that inmates get in prisons in this country sucks. And it's intended to demonstrate that there's a great deal of potential that could be made if, and this was Governor Cuomo's point, if we simply invested in doing more. We started by creaming. I mean, let's be clear, we got folk who are quite handsome. There's a video that is on the BPI webpage that I would refer you guys to. It's the graduation of Woodbourne in 2014, and you'll see a bunch of very articulate, beautifully presenting young men. Weren't that young, they're just younger than me, talking about their experience. And the idea is it's intended to give the notion that maybe we should be rethinking the notion of, about where we're putting our dollars. Now, Governor Cuomo's proposal that the state get behind this was basically rejected because the highly Republican state Senate was very concerned about its constituency, thinking, I've worked all my life, I've been a good citizen, I'm struggling to put my kids in school, and all of a sudden, guys who've committed a crime, some of them terrible crimes, are getting a free education from a professor at Columbia University. It couldn't stand the heat, so they dropped the notion. Thankfully, this summer, Barack Obama decided to order the U.S. Department of Education on an experimental basis to reinstate Pell Grants in many jurisdictions throughout the United States just to see whether or not they could replicate the BARD experience, and I think also, though it's not really stated, and then to do a rigorous evaluation of what's going on. Let me tell you that the RAND Corporation did a study in 2012 of the impact of education on the inside on recidivism and incarceration. They pointed out the following. You have a 43% drop in recidivism rates where inmates have gotten some kind of education. That the cost of providing that education far outweigh the cost of re-incarceration through recidivism. They also pointed out that for every $1 you spend on education, you basically as a nation gain $5 that you wouldn't spend on recidivism rates. Saying that the question isn't whether or not we should do education on the inside, it's what kind and what form. So the notion that we have statistics that look good might be, of course, challenged greatly by those of us with the capacity to do an examination of the nature of the research that was done. But as a crude estimate of the possibilities, the difference between the 77% recidivism rate nationally after 5 years, which is what the Bureau of Justice Statistics found in 2014, and a 4% rate is so is so vast that I think even a doubtful person would have to say, maybe there's something here that we should be looking at more closely. And that is what I think I would commend to the attention of anybody who, after being so concerned about all the problems we've raised over the course of the last 2 days, is looking for some kind of solution that for an audience of folk at a university is within our grasp, within our power to do.
If I could just add a sentence, I agree with both of you. I mean, I think that was a terrific answer, and yet also I'd love to see a randomized controlled trial where we had a wait list of people who couldn't get into the thing randomly selected and get the get a good causal estimate of what the
And as soon as we get the end, of course, that's all going to be possible.
But where you have such a huge difference in the recidivism rates.
There's a very plausible case that something's working here,
Yeah,
and I think the point you're making is that if the vast majority of folk on the inside have almost no education, this is a special population that we've been able to identify. But in the video I sort of commend to your attention, the first speaker is a guy named Adrian Graves, who begins with the following. He's got his cap and gown, he's about to get his BA degree. He says, 15 years ago when I was at Eastern, I used to see guys enrolling in BPI and I thought, ooh, I wish I could be like that. This is a guy who came to prison without a high school diploma, was so motivated by what he saw at Eastern that he made the decision, okay, I'm gonna be like those guys. And one, I think, impact of having so many of the gangster legends, these aren't the nerds that are in my class, so many of the gangster legends taking up education and saying, this is what I'm gonna do to change my life, has a tremendous impact on the social networks that exist on the inside, which are tight, which are firmly established, and where word of something like this has real power to change behavior.
Did you have a question? Yeah, please.
So thank you all for being here and for what you shared. I was thinking about about measurement, and in particular, life expectancy. And there's the use of life expectancy at birth, where a lot of the improvements in life expectancy that we observe come from improvements in early life expectancy, which I think gets at this point about the difficulty of treating, or what's problematic about treating all lives or all years as equal. And disability-adjusted life years was mentioned more recently, so this concept of incarceration-adjusted life years. And those are different, they're sort of different specific ways of getting at quality of life. And so I wonder what your thoughts are about measurement and how do we get at something that dangerously skirts getting into real ethical questions of quality of life. So that's one thing. And just have a real quick comment, just in response to the idea that police killings might be fundamentally different than lynching, I think it's a matter of degree rather than kind, that now we have professionals, that it's the professionalization of police that segregate a lot of us from a daily experience and enactment of violence. And that it allows us, that in fact, one of the things that could really, that's much worse maybe, is that difference makes it very difficult to directly engage in the individual consciousness, the violence that's there. And that when we're talking about the emphasis on problems in public health and difficulty solutions, I mean, is it, not to be a technocrat, but is it cell phone cameras that's been the biggest revolution that has the greatest hope for illuminating conditions that we've otherwise been able to segregate ourselves from?
So let me go first, because it sounded like a couple of those questions were probably for me, at least to start with. The issue about whether police, some of the police killings are how similar they are to lynching. It's really vexed. Would be a very long conversation. I think everybody in the audience thinks that an unjustified police killing is a bad thing, and that's really all we need to agree on, I think, to kind of discuss a lot of this stuff. And that's not to say your question is unimportant, but let's try to do it offline, because I think it would take the rest of the time. Okay, second thing, yes, about measurement. There are many ways we could measure. Daryl raised one. You're raising another. I think most of them are going to come to relatively similar conclusions about the severity of the problem of inequality. I could be wrong about that. It's worth going through the exercise to prove that, but that would be my hunch. I don't think there's anything morally wrong about calculating a life expectancy, even if there's a moral argument that, if that's what you're suggesting, and you might not have been, even if there is an argument to saying there's something else that is, from some sense, better, I think that, for one thing, it's very straightforward how to do that from the available data, and it's the only way I could get a historical series of anything, right? So there are many issues about, I mean, I don't actually think that for example, Black kids born in 2011 will actually experience that degree of life expectancy difference because of various positive changes that we don't really fully understand that will happen. Nevertheless, it's a more precise quantification of the problem than, given the scope of what we want to talk about, than almost anything I can think of doing. So that's a sort of pragmatic justification. I think the question you raise is interesting. There might have been a third question, but I'd rather let Bob and Paula respond.
Well, I have a brief comment about the issue of, you know, using quality-adjusted life years. I think there's always a trade-off when you get a sort of a fancier, more complex measure. It's more opaque to the public, and so I think often that's really not the way to go. And there has been a lot of criticism, of course, of qualities. Yes.
If we have time for more questions, this gentleman is waiting a long time. No, in the hat, sir. And then Townsend.
Hello, so I have a couple of questions. So here it was mentioned that we should maybe invest in the idea of giving inmates BAs and having them be patient advocates, et cetera. One thing that I think of that is that may potentially allow some psychopath personalities in leadership positions, which obviously wouldn't be good. I can imagine that it is beneficial for some inmates to get education because maybe they're interested or they want to turn their lives around and stuff like that. But I don't believe we can educate 100% of the inmate population. One, because it's not financially feasible when considering the debt that this country's in right now. And two, certain people make choices, and if they made a choice not to complete their high school education, the question becomes, should we get our country in more debt because a certain amount or a certain group of people did not make the right choices and may not even be interested in making the right choices? Should we get into debt by forcing them to get educated?
I don't think I said any of that. Where did you get that from? Look, think about herd immunity. You don't have to have everybody in a community vaccinated in order to prevent infectious diseases from becoming problematic. All I'm suggesting is that in some states, you get nothing. We're so much about punishment and not rehabilitation. And with states like California, literally under receivership from the federal courts, because of their failure to deal with issues of overcrowding. I mean, basically, in 2007, the federal court said, overcrowding in prison is so bad that the health care that should be the right of every inmate can't be provided. That is essentially cruel and unusual punishment. So the states are increasingly, by the courts, being required to do something other than to just keep people locked up. And please understand, there was a point before 1970 when the prison population became overwhelmingly Black and Hispanic, when you could get an education on the inside. Up until 1994, there were about 400 college programs in prisons all over the country that basically died at the point Pell Grants were suspended. The idea that you could make quality education on the inside available and that would have all kinds of benefits when people came back to the community and stayed there, got jobs, paid taxes, became contributing members of their community. That's the vision that I think you want to have in a society, a democracy, that wants to rehabilitate people who've made a mistake. Yes, yes, yes. Choice is involved in all these things. And understand, since many of my guys went in at the age of 16 or 17, because in the state of New York, when you're 16 and you've committed a crime, you've been tried as an adult. In their late 30s and 40s, they suddenly see, you know, that was dumb. And the notion that they've been given a second chance is actually represented in legislation that the Congress passed called the Second Chance Act, which recognizes that maybe in a society like ours, the more humane thing to do would be to provide incarceration as a possibility for folks to rethink their choices, get a second chance, reintegrate into society, and do the things that are necessary. And can we be clear? Prisons have, in fact, you're correct, become the place where we lock up a lot of our folk who are struggling with mental health issues. We used to have them in state facilities, then we cut them out, and at that point in 1970, where you had almost no folk with a mental illness in prison, all of a sudden maybe one out of every six is dealing with a serious mental disorder. That's going to be problematic for everybody concerned. What I'm suggesting is that this is a modest proposal that could make things better and could deal with the economic issues that you cite so eloquently as being one of the reasons why we can't do it. I think we don't have a choice. I think we can't afford as a society to continue to have so many people in a facility where, as Michelle Alexander points out, they'll get out as second-class citizens and in many states completely unable to do very much else in their communities other than commit crimes and go back in prison again. It's no longer a solution, it's become a problem.
Now, I'm worried we're encroaching on the next panel's time. Do I have time for one more question?
Yes.
Done, or should we stop? Okay, I'm gonna take that as a yes. Derek, did you?
Sorry, I just had a
yeah, please.
Presentation. In view of the discussion of race, the power of illusion is a terrific evaluation analysis of race as a social construction, a California newsreel documentary that folks can take a look at, and Ernest Drucker's work, who's like, I would believe a colleague of yours,
yes,
Dr. Fulton,
yeah.
Has written a wonderful book called The Plague of Prisons, where he discusses the themes that Dr. Fulton has explored, within all the panels, but Dr. Fulton has explored. And I just wondered if you could follow, could you put it, both the Bard program in Dr. Drucker's framing of primary, secondary, and tertiary prevention? How would you step us toward a greater level of getting to the tertiary prevention expression to disengage ourselves from mass incarceration and its collateral consequences?
You know, it took me about 2 hours to read the chapter where he described that. I've got about a minute. I think what I've tried to suggest is that with so many folk leaving communities that are characterized by health disparities, they go into the prison where, let's be clear, this is not where you want to go for your health. So they're likely to return to the community in poorer health than they were when they went, contributing to the burden of health disparities that already exist in these settings. If they are one of the primary causes for the expansion and the growth of health disparities in these communities, thinking about them as the index population to which we ought to start to think about making investments, educational investments, which are relatively cheap, we might start to see changes in the notions that in order to promote health and prevent disease, maybe dealing with this problem first should be our primary priority. How's that?
Thank you very much for your time.